Good morning. Hamjambo. Salimi mwenzako. Turn to your neighbor on your right, on your left. Just say hello. Find out how was their week. If they are not smiling, just smile at them. Tell them, you won't crack if you smile, surely. Amen. You all look lovely. Amen. And you see, Pastor always says this, you know, when he stands here, he looks around and he sees lovely faces, lovely smiles. And the Bible says, where two witnesses are there, a word is established. So I'm a witness to that. And so this word is established. You all look lovely. Amen. Hallelujah. Yeah, we thank God we are fearfully and wonderfully made. Yes. And so this morning I want us to share very briefly from his word. But before I do that, remember what Paul says or what he does in the beginning of every epistle. Do you know what it says? Greetings? Yeah, but there is a particular word, a particular greeting that he makes. Grace to you and peace from God, our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ. I want you to speak that to your neighbor because you're prophesying that the grace of God be upon you, the peace of God be upon you. So say grace to you. And peace from God our Father be upon you. Amen. Last week we shared about our destiny. Basically, we are looking at the purpose of God for each and every one of us. And we realized that each and every person here has been called by God. And God has a purpose. God has a name. God has a destiny specifically for you. You have a role that you need, that only you can play in this life. There's nobody else that is going to do if you fail or if you don't or if you disobey. Then the body of Christ will be handicapped. Bwana asifiwe. And so we need you to discover your role. We need you to discover your call. We need you to discover your function because that is what God has called you. That is what is recognized in heaven. And so we saw that even before the worlds were established, before the beginning of time, God already had a plan for you. Before even you were formed in the mother of your womb, God already called you. And he had designated something for you. We read in Ephesians that we are a masterpiece. You know, we were not just haphazardly formed. You just didn't come into being. You know, it doesn't matter the circumstances that brought you into life. It does not matter the circumstances of your life. You are a masterpiece that God has purposed. You are not just there. And so God established what he intended for you even before the creation of this world. Bwana asifiwe. So it's a great honor to know this God and to realize that I have a call. It's not Pastor Munene. It's not those who serve here. Bwana asifiwe. We also learned that in the body, there are different parts. And we realize, you know, by the mentioning of the kidney, nobody has seen the kidney or the liver. Sindio? And we have discovered that actually when you think deeper, you realize the most vital organs are actually not visible. Bwana asifiwe. So you could be here thinking that no one notices me, no one recognizes me, no one sees what I'm doing. or my function in God, but you could be the most important person in the body of Christ. And so we need you. Can you tell that to your neighbor? We need you to function. Bwana asifiwe. I mean, the heart is very vital, right? I mean, if the liver fails, the entire body dies. Huh? Ama nasema uongo. If the lungs fail, the entire body dies. You know, the eyes, the ears, the hands, the legs, finished. Bwana asifiwe. And that is what God is calling us to be. That is where God is calling us to come to that place where we all begin to fully function. Because the moment we begin to fully function in that which God has called us to do, then there will be such great unity. Bwana asifiwe. I mean, there'll be no envying, there'll be no jealousy, there'll be no, this guy is more important than the other. Bwana asifiwe. And so, I would encourage you after this also to go look at the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 12. From verse 12, read through up to verse 27 there. That's a homework I'm giving you. And you see that every part in our body, we all belong to one another. The eye cannot say to the hand that I don't need you. The hand cannot say to the ear that I don't need you. But we all need each other. And we all belong to one another. And your function is what I need for me to function. Bwana asifiwe. I can't function without you. You see? You're so important and I need you. Bwana asifiwe. And so today, we on that very mood or on that very context, we want to look a little bit in how we can live within our destiny or how to live out our destiny. We're going to look at a few passages of scripture. We read about Abraham, God changing his name from Abram, that is an exalted or a high father, to Abraham, that is father of nations or multitudes. And we also read about Gideon, whose name means warrior, but God called him valiant or a mighty man of God or a valiant soldier. Bwana asifiwe. Hallelujah. In the Swahili version, it says shuja. You know, if you hear the word shuja, what does it bring to mind? Maybe some of you are rugby fans, eh? What comes to you to mind is the sevens. Eh? But shuja, that's what God called Gideon. And yet Gideon was the youngest in a clan which was the least. You know, I just love this God. Because he calls those things which are not as though they were. Amen? And so when God calls you, he does not depend on you to fulfill it. Bwana asifiwe. And when he calls you, the call that he gives you, you have no capacity for you to accomplish it. It will take him. Bwana asifiwe. He told Jeremiah that he watches over his word to perform it. Thank you, brother. Bwana asifiwe. And so the God who has called you will always ensure that he will perform the call upon your life. All you need to do is to obey. Bwana asifiwe. Now, if we look at the book of Genesis chapter 12, we'll read the same passages we read last week, and maybe we'll go a little bit deeper and see what actions these men of God or these people took. The Bible says, the Lord told Abraham, you are to leave your land. Genesis chapter 12 verse 1. You are to leave your land, your relatives, and your father's house and go to the land I'm going to show you. I'll make a great nation of your descendants. I'll bless you and I'll make your reputation great so that you'll be a blessing. I'll bless those who bless you, but I'll curse the one who curses you, and through you all the people of the earth will be blessed. So Abram left there as the Lord had directed him, and Lot accompanied him. Abraham was 75 years old when he left Haran. Abram took his wife, Sarai, his nephew Lot, all the possessions they had accumulated, and the servants he had acquired while living in Haran. Then they set out to go to the land of Canaan. When they arrived in the land of Canaan, Abram traveled through the land to the place called Shechem, as far as the Oak of Moreh. We can read that passage up to verse 8. But the lesson is that God called Abraham and he told him, you are to leave your land, you are to leave your relatives and your father's house and go to the land I'm going to show you. How easy was that to do for Abraham? Imagine a 75-year-old. I mean, that's your for some of you, it's your grandfather's age. Sindio? So imagine your grandfather or your father, for some of you, your parents. Can you imagine your 75-year-old dad comes to you and tells you, God has called me and is asking me to leave this family. To leave this village, to leave these people, to leave this clan. Do you think it was easy? I mean, Abraham was set. This is a retired man today. Sindio? Anakula matunda yake, pension yake. Bwana sifiwe. Ana enjoy maisha yake, watoto wake, wajukuu na labda hata vitukuu. Bwana sifiwe. Because we rejoice in those things. Bwana sifiwe. But the Lord told Abraham, you are to leave what? Your land. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 11 that by faith Abraham obeyed God. And he sojourned to a land which he did not know, living as a stranger in tents, looking for that city whose builder and maker was God. Because he had faith in God. Abraham had the voice of God. It does not matter where you are at. The moment you hear the voice of God, you will know it is God. And this is what Abraham had. But Abraham made the decision to obey God and to move and to begin to walk with him. And so, it was not easy, but Abraham obeyed God. Why? Because God is calling us today also to a place like Abraham where we can value him above all else. And let it not be just by lip service when we come to church on Sunday and we open our lips and we sing, we lift our hands and we sing. That is okay, so long as we do it from the heart. Bwana sifiwe. And that is where God is calling us to do, that we may live for him and our service will be from the heart. God warned the nation of Israel, I think it's through Jeremiah. Is it Jeremiah or Isaiah? Where he say, with their lips they are near me, but with their hearts they are far from. So God is calling us to that place where we can draw closer to him, or where we will truly value him from the heart. So the question to ask is, where was God? I mean, wasn't God there when Abraham was, let's say, 20 years old or 30 years old? Why did he wait until Abraham was 75? And then waited again, Abraham amehama, amehenda, until he was 90 before he changed his name. And then waited again until he was 99 to give him a son. Because there is a process. Bwana asifiwe. But the Bible, we have realized from the Bible that God is not a respecter of persons, and he demands obedience from all of us. Amen? And from the book of Romans, we see that Abraham did not struggle in obeying God, but he had hope against hope. Bwana asifiwe. Despite his age and circumstances, he trusted God, and he did not rely on the norms and in the trends of the time. Do we look at the norms and the trends of today? Do they affect us? Because God called Abraham to a destiny that only God himself could accomplish it for him. Bwana asifiwe. Now let us look at the story of Gideon, and then we will look at three lessons that we are getting from these two people. If you look at Judges 6, if you read Judges 6 verse 11 all the way to 34, you see what happened to Gideon. I'm going to read a few verses, but I'll encourage you to read all the entire passage, 11 to 34. The Bible says, after this, the angel of the Lord arrived and sat down in the shade of the oak tree in Ophrah that belonged to Joash, a descendant of Abiezer. While his son Gideon was threshing wheat in a winepress in order to safeguard it from the Midianites, the angel of the Lord appeared to him and told him, "The Lord is with you, you valiant warrior." But Gideon replied, "Right, sir. If the Lord is with us, then why has all this happened to us? And where are all these miraculous works that our ancestors recounted to us when they said, 'The Lord brought us up from Egypt,' didn't he? But now the Lord has abandoned us and given us over to Midian." The Lord looked straight to him and replied, "Go with this determination of yours and deliver Israel from Midian's domination. I've directed you, haven't I?" "Right," Gideon responded. "Sir, how will I deliver Israel? Look, my family is the weakest in Manasseh, and I'm the youngest in my father's household." But the Lord told him, because I'll be with you, and you'll defeat Midian, every single one of them. Bwana asifiwe. The call that Gideon received, Gideon was the youngest and was the weakest. We always make excuses before God. Isn't that right? We make excuses before God. But God does not rely on you. Mind you, he used only 300 men with Gideon. Bwana asifiwe. And with those 300 men, Gideon was able to pursue an army of 135 and defeat it. Bwana asifiwe. But from this passage, we see that God did not only call Gideon, but he gave him certain specific instructions. If we look at from verse 24 onwards, we see that Gideon built an altar to the Lord. And then the following verse, in verse 25, we see that the Lord told Gideon and he commanded him specifically to build him an altar, to tear down the altar of his father. Bwana asifiwe. He specifically told him, "Take the bull that belongs to your father, along with a second bull," verse 25, Judges 6, "that's 7 years old. Then tear down the altar to Baal that your father owns, cut down the Asherah that's beside it, and build an altar to the Lord, your God, on top of this stronghold in an orderly manner. Then take the second bull and offer it as a burnt offering, using the wood from the Asherah that you'll be cutting down." And so Gideon went with 10 men who were his servants and did just what the Lord had told him to do, though he did it at night because he was too afraid of his father's family and the leading men of the city to do it during the day. Bwana sifiwe. Gideon obeyed. Bwana sifiwe. The instructions of the Lord were that he tear down the altars of his father. Bwana sifiwe. We all come from different backgrounds, and we've been raised up differently. Maybe there are certain characteristics ordinances that we follow based on our upbringing. There are things that we value based on where we come from. But I want to ask, is what we are doing or what we are practicing glorifying the Lord? Now that you have found the Lord, if you look back, or if you examine yourself, the things that you value, the things that you have inherited, the culture that you're practicing, are they really in line with the Word of God? Are they really in line with what the Spirit of the Lord is asking you to do? Are you at peace with what you're doing? You see, friends, the Bible says in the book of 1 Peter, chapter 1, I believe from verse 17 there, it says that silver and gold, we have not been redeemed by silver and gold from the corrupt way of life or from the vain traditions that we have inherited from who? Those who know that scripture. Oh, don't go quiet on me. From your fathers. Amtaki kusema, you fear your parents, huh? Or is it you love them? Well, the Bible says honor them, honor your father and your mother, but it does not say that you disobey the Lord in doing that. Let me repeat that. The scripture says honor your father and your mother, but it does not say that you disobey the Lord in doing that. Bwana asifiwe. And so let us read, kwa sababu mmeninyamazia, waraka wa kwanza wa Petero. Mlango wa kwanza, mstari wa 20, wa 17 ama 18, wacha niangalie ni mstari gani. Anyway, for those who are not hearers of Swahili, I happen to have that gift of interpreting Swahili to English also to a certain degree. So 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 18. "Knowing that you are not redeemed with corruptible things like silver or gold from your aimless conduct received by tradition from your fathers." From who? "But with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot." But the point here is that, what are we inheriting from our fathers? Huh? What did you invent? What did you inherit? Please say it. It is not me. Just echo what the Bible is saying. What did you inherit? Vain traditions. Bwana sifiwe. Unfruitful culture and practices that we have inherited. And that is why you'll find today a certain community has specific characteristics. Sindio? Eh? Sitasema kina nani ama nani, lakini you know it very well. Right? We hold on to those traditions and those culture, tutasema sisi tunafanya hivi. Bwana asifiwe. But God told Gideon to do what? To destroy the altar. So my question is, what altars are we building? Or what altars have we established in our lives? Are we still serving the altars of our fathers from the past? Or have we established altars unto the Lord? Maybe by doing that, maybe before we do that, we need to understand what is an altar. Bwana asifiwe. There are several definitions of an altar. But an altar is a place where the divine and human worlds interacted. We've read Judges. If you read chapter 6, verse 22 to 24, you'll see that the divine and human worlds interacted. Gideon was visited by an angel, right? Correct? And he established an altar in that place. Bwana asifiwe. It's a place of exchange, communication, and influence. We see that Jacob, when his parents sent him to go to his mother's family or community to go and look for a wife, on his journey, he got to a place where he laid down to sleep, and he had a stone for a pillow. You'll see that in the book of Genesis, I believe, chapter 28, sorry. And he laid down and he had a dream. And in that dream, he saw angels ascending and descending, and the Lord standing at the top. And God spoke to him. Bwana asifiwe. And when he woke up, the Bible says he made a pillar from that stone, from those rocks, and he poured oil on it. And he made a vow. And he called that place a house of God. Bethel is its name. Bwana asifiwe. So that is a place because there was a divine, there's an interaction from the divine to the human world. And also there was an communication, an exchange of communication and influence, because Jacob was influenced from that moment. Bwana asifiwe. And we can see also from that very passage in Genesis 28 that an altar is a place of worship. Bwana asifiwe. And so, it is also a gate. From that very passage, Genesis 28, 11 to 28, if you will read it, that it is a gate into the realm of the spirit. Because it was not just an empty dream, but God revealed himself to Jacob. Bwana asifiwe. So, are those altars you're holding on to, or the altars that you have established, what do they speak in your life? Do they cause you to draw nearer to God? What kind of influences are you deriving? Who is influencing you? What kind of communication are you receiving? Are you getting nourished? Are you getting closer to God? Are you being established in your walk with God? Bwana asifiwe. Yesterday, we've been doing, as men, we have this mission that we are doing to the Bostol prison. Every Saturday from 2 to 4 p.m., we go there and we are using one material to mentor those boys, you know, and to try to bring them up so that they can be men after God's heart. Amen. And so if there is there is anyone here, men especially, this is a challenge to you, that we need you to come up so that we can really mentor these people We need you to take up your purposes. Take up your mantle. Bwana asifiwe. And so yesterday when you were there, it's been 2-way traffic. Because these boys are learning from us, but you are learning a lot from them also. Bwana asifiwe. I mean, if you think you know things or you've heard things, then you need to spend time also sometimes with prisoners. And these are young boys. Bwana asifiwe. But yesterday when you were coming back, I was with a few men. I think we were about four persons. And in our discussion from the teams that they were leading, some of them, we came up with this conversation that there are certain beliefs, traditions, and values that are instilled in boys during circumcision. And we came to realize that the values that are being instilled in these people are really against, or rather they go contrary to what the Word of God is. Because they will tell you that, and I know many of you here will bear witness with me, that after you are circumcised, it is implied that it is okay for you to go ahead and have sex. True or not? I mean, you are a man. Waume mlisini nyamazie kweli ama orongo? I mean, these are the things that people are taught. And we are Kenyans. Bwana sifiwe. Na mko hapa mnajua. That this is, you know, for you to be a man, this is what you should do. Or maybe now that you are grown up, so you need to buy everyone cigarettes. Or buy everyone a drink, you know? Because you are a man. It is demanded and required of you. So people grow up with those values. And now you are reaching out to this person and you are trying to bring him to a place whereby he can realize that what I believe in is actually wrong. Now, if these are not altars, what are they? You tell me. Bwana asifiwe. If they are not altars, what are they? And God told Gideon to tear down the altars of who? His father. And God is calling us today. If we are to enter into that place of purpose, God is calling us to a place where we can disconnect and begin to establish altars of worship unto God. Bwana asifiwe. So, are there altars in your life? Are they there? What is it that you're holding on to? We all come from a background where our ancestors did not worship the true God. They are actually worshiping idols, true or not? Okay? And you discover those traditions and cultures are still being instilled through the value and the belief system. It is still being handed over, you know, even to us. So if we are not careful, we may find ourselves fighting against God by holding on to those values. And so we need to forsake everything that is vain, that we have inherited from our ancestors. Bwana asifiwe. Joshua in the book of in chapter 24, in the book of Joshua chapter 24, verse 2 and 3, he says, "And Joshua said to all the people, So says Jehovah, the God of Israel, your fathers lived beyond the river in times past, Terah, the father of Abraham, and the father of Nahor, and they served other gods. And I took your father Abraham from beyond the river and led him throughout all the land of Canaan and multiplied his seed and gave him Isaac. God had to take Abraham out of his community, out of his culture, out of his, he had to depart from his gods. And that is what God is calling us to do today. We have, if we are to enter into that place of inheritance and walking with God, fulfilling our purposes, walking in the destiny that God has ordained for you, then you have to break and you have to tear down the altars of your forefathers. Amen. So that you will cease from being called a Kikuyu, a Mkamba, a Mtaita, wanasifiwe, and you become a true ambassador of Christ. Wanasifiwe. According to 2 Corinthians 5:17, you are an ambassador of Christ. And Paul says in Philippians 3:19 that your citizenship is of. So what kind of citizen, what characteristic does a citizen of heaven have? Does he hold on to the values of this earth? You have been set apart because your destiny has been transformed. Bwana asifiwe. And so, once we do that, before we cannot be able to walk with God or to be able to walk in the Spirit until we begin or we have begun to establish altars unto the Lord. Bwana asifiwe. And so you have to offer yourself as a living sacrifice. Because the altar of your heart now has to be occupied. God has to take over the throne that is in your life, that is in your heart. Because from there, only from there will God begin to communicate with you and will begin to influence you, because you are a spirit that has a soul and lives in a body. You're not the other way around. So what I'm looking at and what you're looking at is not what you see or is not what you get. It's not the real thing. Si mnaniona sura, but that's not the real thing. Mimi nakuona sura, sio? But that's not the real thing. The Bible says in Proverbs 20:27 that the spirit of man is the lamp of the Lord or the candle of the Lord, searching all the inward parts of the belly. Or in other translations, searching all the innermost things. So God begins to communicate with you from the spirit. And he will begin to talk to you from that dimension. But you need to lay an altar and sacrifice. Offer your body as a living sacrifice unto him. Bwana asifiwe. Abraham offered himself. He forsook everything. Bwana asifiwe. And so God will begin to communicate. Does not mean that God does not speak audibly. He does. Bwana asifiwe. Yeah, he does. When he was giving the Ten Commandments, if you read Exodus 20, he spoke. But at the end, verse 24, there about, the Bible says even the Hebrews, the Jews, the children of Israel were afraid because of the thunderings. They were so afraid, they told Moses, we ongea na Mungu tutasikia, we will hear and we will listen. Bwana asifiwe. Amen. So we need to come to that experience where we will truly fear God. Bwana asifiwe. Like the children of Israel. Amen. In Job 32:8 says, however, a spirit exists in mankind and the Almighty's breath gives him insight. Bwana asifiwe. So your spirit is the place in which God will reside and will begin to give you directions. And so Paul says that we bear or we carry this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power will reside in God, or rather belongs to God. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. So we carry, we bear so much treasure. And Pastor has alluded to that. He has shared that scripture where the woman came and broke the alabaster box. And so like that box, there is so much treasure in us, but we have to be broken so that it may begin to flow, that we may begin to walk in the Spirit. Paul, in his letter to the Galatians, chapter 5, 17, he says, walk in the Spirit, and you will not fulfill the desires of the flesh. And so three things that we have seen from these scriptures is that the first thing, when you hear the voice of God, the thing you need to do is to obey. I'm not teaching anything new, but I'm reminding us that the first thing you need to do is to obey. Abraham, when he heard the voice, he obeyed. The second thing that you need to do is to destroy the altars that will hinder you. What is it that hinders you? You have to take a break from it. You have to depart from it. Turn away from it. And the last thing you need to do is to walk with God. Begin to walk in the Spirit with God. Obey. Tear down the altars. Establish altars unto the Lord. By the way, an altar is a place of remembrance also of God's deeds and of God's encounters. Because when he gave them the Ten Commandments in Exodus 20, God says that he will bring them to that place, in that altar he will visit, and he will cause them to remember. And as they remember, he will bless them. So an altar, when you establish those altars in your life, establish altars that will cause you to remember the Lord always. Isaiah 26:3 says, he will keep you in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on him. And so begin to establish those altars and serve the only true God. I could share much more that the Lord has spoken unto us. But I believe with those three, if you are willing and you are obedient, you'll eat the good of the land. Amen. In obedience and trust is your strength. So let's rise up. Just open your lips unto the Lord. Begin to pray for yourself. If there are any altars, there are things, you know yourself, and God knows you. If you need to confess before him, you need to renounce their altars, their gods that you're keeping, that you're holding. Just get rid of them. Renounce them. Refuse them. Make a vow unto the Lord. Abraham made a covenant. And Father, I commit your people to you this morning, that you'll visit them in their lives, in their hearts, and cause them to establish altars unto you, Lord. Landmarks that will cause them to remember you, that will cause them to walk with you. That, Lord, they will forgo of everything that pulls them back, that which you abhor, that which you detest. And Lord, they will honor you as the only true God. And so if you are here, you've been holding on to altars. Maybe you know there are things that are hindering your life. And you're struggling to in your walk with the Lord. Things may not be working out. You find you're hindered in one way or the other in your walk with God. And you are being convicted right now to get rid of those altars. Just raise your hand and I will pray with you. If you are there and you know there are altars in your life, thank you for those hands. Father in heaven, we want to thank you. We bless you, Lord, and we honor you, Lord. I want to raise up, to lift up your people before you, Lord. Lord, by raising their hands, it's a confession that they need you. And it's a statement of faith, Lord, that they are renouncing, they are committing themselves to renounce those altars and those gods that are false. And therefore, Lord, I pray that you visit them. Cause them to have a turnaround. Tear down every altar that has been established that is not of you, Lord. Bring it down. And cause, you are a consuming fire. By your fire, Lord, may you consume all these altars and all these false gods in the name of Jesus. Cause your people to begin to walk in freedom and in the victory that you have purpose for them. And so, Father, we thank you because of your mercy, of your love, and of your goodness. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you.